We're live, y'all, with the incredible Lori Allen right here in Georgia for Happy Hour at Home. How are you doing today, Lori, and every day for that matter?
I'm doing great. I'm glad to be here.
I'm so glad. I know. Well, I would have made you one, but I made it kind of in your honor. Although I used some California whiskey, I made a Lynchburg lemonade, and it's delicious, I have to say. It is good. It is good. I know, but you've been in Georgia a long time, and everybody knows you from TLC's Say Yes to the Dress, and you just put out your very first book this year, or this week, I should say. Even.
This week. It came out Wednesday, and the book's entitled Say Yes to What's Next. Mm-hmm. So it's been a crazy busy week of media and promotion and that sort of thing. And, you know, everything has to be done this way now, and it's been different and unusual.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I know. I mean, it has been really crazy. Just everything that's going on. And how has that affected your business? Because we know, you know, my radio station, New Country 101.5, and my company, Cumulus, we've been really urging small businesses here in Georgia to get a hold of us because, you know, to be honest, we've been kind of giving away some advertising because we are trying so hard to support small business, which has taken probably the biggest hit of anybody in the United States.
Well, you know, Bridal had we closed the store for 2 months. To begin mm-hmm. with. And then this will be my 40th year in Sandy Springs at Bridal Spa Lori. And I've never closed but more than a day or so, you know, or two for our snow days, you know, when we have three flakes and we close.
Yeah.
So I closed the store 2 months. It was scary. We had to leave. I left all the customer service people answering the phones remotely. And we received our dresses off premises because, you know, we got to keep continuing getting this merchandise in.
Right.
It's been crazy. A lot of girls have rejigged, you know, like moved it back or scaled way down. All of them, though, thank goodness, are still going to wear their dress because, you know, that's like so important.
Even yes, it is.
Scaling down, you want to feel fantastic.
Yeah.
And so they're still wearing their dresses. So we're still trying to get them in time. The factory's closed. I mean, it has been crazy. And then we had to define a new way to shop for bridal because bridal is a very touchy feely, as you see on the show. We put your veil on, we hug you, we put the gowns on you. Yeah. You know, you can't do that.
Yeah. Well, always a bridesmaid. And I know that like, when you go into the store, often the dresses are bigger and they cinch you in and then they have to be altered and all
that
stuff.
Right.
How are you doing that?
But now we have to put up the sneeze screen and the mask and we take temperatures when you come in. You have to bring someone in your party in order to dress you because we can't get that close to you because of 6 feet distancing.
Right.
And the craziest thing of all is trying to see if a bride likes a gown or not with this all covered. You know, all we're seeing is her eyes. So you can't really even tell if she likes it or not, Corey. I'm like, do you like it? Is that the one?
You can't read their face. They got a poker face only because they got a mask on.
It's much more difficult right now. It is.
Well, let me ask you this. I mean, here's an interesting wrinkle. I mean, I don't know if brides are really wearing the veils. I guess some do. Are you making bridal masks? Is that like a new thing?
Some of the manufacturers are making masks, you know, and I've seen them that say bride and that sort of thing on them.
Yeah.
But we're not making them ourselves. But yeah, I've seen brides and grooms like that have gotten married at home and then they go outside because they want to remember the times like you could ever forget that this was 2020 and we all want to go backwards. But they have the mask on. I've seen that.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. And I mean, are you still able to like serve champagne? I mean, have some of the things just, you've just had to adjust everything.
Everything.
That's one of the big bummers about flying that I'm bummed about.
Yeah. I actually like, I shot a video. It looked crazy, but I shot it in the store of what it was going to be like shopping at Bridal Spa Lori now, because I didn't want people to come in and be afraid and to see that we were doing all these measures to keep things clean and sanitary and for the health of not only our employees, I've got 32 employees, and then also all these customers coming in. I wanted everyone to be safe as we can be in these times. So, I mean, I feel like during these times, real leaders step up to the plate. You got to figure out a way to make this work for your business. Yeah. And I've seen it all over the place with restaurants, delivering, you know, curbside service. They were up and running. I know they're not at the same capacity, but they are at least getting some revenue going.
Yeah, they're just, I mean, you have to just figure out a way to make it happen. I mean, you know, have lots of friends in radio who have lost their job or whatever industry they're in, they've lost their job. And I'm like, you know, and there's talk that 40% or more of these jobs aren't coming back.
Right.
And, you know, I mean, I guess you can, you know, moan about that, bemoan it, and, or you can just fix it and figure out something else to do.
That's right.
I mean, it's really difficult. I understand.
Yeah. This is a time to explore your passions. And that's why I went ahead with my book date release, because I was like, I could wait, I could do this in the fall, you know, but I feel like at this point in time, we've got a little bit more time, Corey, to explore what we want to do and to figure out what our say yes to what's next is, you know?
Right.
It's a time of reflection that I feel like we've never had before. I know in my years, I've never had any, you know.
Well, you can go. You opened up the store, what, 2 weeks or 2 months after graduation?
2 weeks after I graduated from college.
I mean, that's nuts. And I mean, you've been super successful.
That's all I've ever done. And I've always been in Sandy Springs. And, you know, it's just, it's who I am. And I love it still. Love it. So,
yeah.
Not going anywhere.
You know, I mean, and, you know, say yes to the dresses. I don't know if that was your concept, your idea to use that. But a lot of successful people that I know, that's sort of the theme. It's like, say yes to opportunity. Say yes to what's next. And that's the name of your new book that just came out. Where can people get it? First of all, your website.
Yes. Well, Amazon. You can get on LoriAllen.com and it takes you to Barnes & Noble and Amazon and Target. It's sold in many places. So you can get it at many locations. Yeah.
And what, and I know that you had a moment, I guess, that
sort
of got you really feisty as a Southern woman. And you just, I mean, I don't know, you know, you can kind of tell people how this idea spawned to write this book.
Well, for almost 40 years, I've been helping brides and their mothers, you know, kind of try to get along during this time, because even the show is really not about the dress. We like looking at the dresses and all that sort of thing on air, but the bride is really there to get everyone in her entourage, particularly her mother, to agree with this next step in her life. Mm. And once they all say yes to that dress, she feels like, okay, everybody's agreeing with me. This is going to be good. You just see the relief in her face. So really, that's what it's about. So for all these many years, I've been helping the brides and the mothers, and over and over and over, and this is not a new thing, and I'm real jealous of that dream. Over and over and over.
I'll bring you some soon.
The mothers come up, and she's like, our bridal floor is on the third floor. You're going to have to come in.
But I would love to.
So she's upstairs and she's like, I want my baby to have the best. I don't want her in anything but the best. I want Lori, you to fix her from top to bottom. Okay. We get her baby set, the daughter. Everybody's happy. Then later on, she'll come back in for a dress for her. Okay. Mm. For the mom.
Okay. You're right.
And she will go straight to that sale rack. And she's like, you know, I've kind of let myself go. I don't deserve it. She has no self-worth anymore. Mm. And we reach a real crossroads in our life after 50 when, you know, our children are growing up and they're going to high school or they're getting married. And then you've put all this time and effort into your child and your career, or if you didn't have children, your career and all that sort of thing. And you've kind of lost you. And you've kind of lost your passion. And I see it over and over and over again. And I'm wanting to inspire and motivate women over 50 to explore their passions, because we've still got another chapter to go here, another quarter of our cookie. And I want us to take it all the way down to the groom.
I love that. Well, didn't somebody say something to you, I don't know, a couple of years ago saying, oh, are you ready to retire? Yeah. And you're like,
I turned 60 last year. I'm almost 61 next month. And I turned 60. And several people started asking me, well, when are you going to retire? I mean, it was like, I looked at them like they were crazy. I'm like, what? Yeah. When are you going to retire? And then I got mad. I'm like, first off, I have no intention of retiring. And secondly, why would you ask me that? And I don't think my husband was ever asked that at 60 years old, you know? And do you just expect me to fade away into the sunset? Because we have so much left to offer as women over 50. You know, there's so much more for us and so much more for this world to benefit from us. And so it just made me mad. I'm in the shower. I get out of the shower. I call my daughter. my daughter has an advertising agency in Calhoun, Georgia. And I'm like, Molly, I want to write a book. And she's like, what? I said, I want to write a book. I'm coming up. I did. I said, I'm coming up. We're going to lock ourselves in your office for 2 or 3 days. And we're going to write, get this book started. Yeah. So we did that. We did all the chapter titles and wrote the first chapter, and it was picked up right away. Wow. Then we hired the ghostwriter, of course, because I can't write a book. And Molly doesn't have time to write a book. And I mean, you talk about difficult, because I wanted to make sure it reflected me. Every sentence in that book needed to reflect me and how I felt, because I'm the one going through this. I've had all these experiences, and I wanted to share this with readers and motivate them, you know, that you've got so much more to offer than that sale rack.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I know. You know, and I always knew that that day was coming for me, even in broadcasting. I thought it was 50, but I got to tell you, I think for a lot of women in a lot of different industries, it's like 35, 40, and it starts to happen, and people ignore you.
They ignore you. It's like we have no voice anymore. And Corey, if you look at advertising, this is another thing that made me so mad. The advertising for us is for Depends, you know, and it's Walkers. And then Granny has this sweater on, you know, and looks like she's at the retirement home. Well, that's fine. But you know what? That's not us. Right. That's not this beautiful group of smart women that have so much left to offer this world.
Yeah. And experience. Yeah. I mean, it sounds like your book. I mean, I know you guys sent it to me. I'm going to have to read it online.
Oh yeah.
But I mean, it sounds like, you know, like you said, women are, I mean, it's sort of a cultural thing. I think it's like, you're expected to, you know, be the super career woman, and you're expected to raise your family, and you're expected to do it all and have it all and look like Jennifer Lopez at 50.
Exactly.
You know, it's really a challenge for a lot of women and guys too, but you know, but dad bods are all the rage.
Women, I think we're very hard on each other.
Yeah.
Very hard on each other. As the mother of the bride is with the bride on the runway that you see on the show all the time. Yeah. We don't cut each other a break. And women don't congregate enough. Women don't, like we're doing now, we don't chit chat enough. And we don't bring this conversation out into the open enough. You know, we don't support each other enough. I know as a working mom in the 80s, I had 2 children. I felt so guilty. I'm like, but I had my dream and I couldn't give up. I wasn't making any money, but I could not give up. You know, I had this dream. So as a working mom, almost everyone in my neighborhood, there might have been 1 or 2 in there that worked, but I felt so isolated because they all were at home and I could tell they looked down on me because I was working. And, you know, that has all changed now. I'm glad of that. That has changed now. But the fact that we still don't get together with our friends and our girlfriends as much as we should and talk about these subjects, you know, other subjects in the book too, Corey.
Just support each other. And I mean, because there really is enough for everybody, I think. I mean, I told a woman on the radio the other day, I said, how are you getting through this pandemic? And she goes, well, I craft. Uh-huh. And I was like, oh, really? I said, well, how are you finding your customers? How do you find your clientele? And she has a craft business. I think she says she does monograms here in Georgia, and she uses Etsy or Facebook even. Right. Facebook. I mean, there's so many avenues. I think for a lot of people even, the problem is getting started, and you know, it's best obviously to start when you still have a job. But if you don't, and maybe you're getting unemployment and you have this time, it's kind of like sink or swim. Just go for it. That's my advice.
I don't think there's ever been a better time to evaluate your life and to see if you are living your passion and if you are truly happy in your heart. I mean, I still go to work after almost 40 years and still love it. I don't dread work. I get up. I'm happy. I'm ready to go, you know, and, you know, times are harder now, right now, but I feel like, you know, this is when I've got to practice my leadership skills. You know, there's all kinds of hurdles. I've been through 9/11. I've been through the recession of 2008. I've been through breast cancer. I fell flat on my face last year when we were filming. I don't know if you knew this. Say yes.
I do. Yes. Yeah. You have to tell us about that.
The whole nation, I fall flat on my face.
I know.
And so all that is addressed in the book, which are things that happen to people. I mean, that was an accident. You can get in a car accident. You know, all kinds of things happen.
A setback of any physical sort of malady. I mean, it can happen.
Yes. Yes. So, you know, we address all those things. I also address parenting adult children. You talk about hard. Now, that's when you've got to really try to zip it up. And I am not good at zipping it up. I give many instances, Corey, when I am not good at keeping it zipped.
Yeah, I bet you do.
I do, over and over again.
Tell everybody sort of what they're going to get from the book. And then we can talk a little bit more about TLC, Yes to the Dress. I know the season started, I think, your 11th season, which is incredible.
Our 11th season just aired. Yep.
Okay, So it's just finished up? Because I know it was an abbreviated season because of your
accident. We have that long pause because I fell. It threw like the whole production schedule and the airing schedule and all that off now. And now nobody's filming anything.
Yeah.
But with that said, we have just aired season 11. So we've been filming for 10 years now.
Yeah, that's amazing. I know. But are you completely healed from the accident? We'll talk about the accident.
Pretty much.
I know you broke what, a couple of ribs, both your wrists, your face. I mean, you had two black eyes. I mean, did you break your nose too?
I broke my nose. I fell there. We were shooting the opening scene for season 11, and that's actually addressed in the finale. If you go back and watch season 11, it's addressed there. But we're shooting the opening scene, and Monty's taking, you know, this gown around, whirling it around, and it's really funny. We're having the best day. Isn't that when accidents happen?
Yes.
We are laughing. The store's closed. It's on a Wednesday. Our store's closed on Wednesday, so we're doing a lot of filming that day.
Okay.
So they leave the train. The train is tulle. I don't know if you know what that is. Real sheer, okay?
Yeah.
And underneath this real sheer layer is a layer of just nothing but sequins. Okay, so the sequins with the tool that are on top of my hardwood floor that is exactly the same color.
Oh.
Never even would see the thing, okay?
Oh.
So I'm walking past to go change for the next scene and just, and I knew when I slipped, I saw my one foot go in front of the other because it was so slippery. I thought, this is going to be bad, Lori. This is going to be bad. Go to your knees. You know how they always say, go to your knees? I couldn't even do that. It was so fast. And I landed on my face with my hands like this, and I knocked myself out. I woke up in the ambulance, and had a concussion, and then I had a plate and 9 pins put on this side. I mean, this is how crazy this is. And then this wrist was broken. So I'm in 2 casts, broken nose, had to have nose surgery, and 3 ribs. Yeah.
Ouch. And I mean, that must have, so when did that happen? I mean, how many months did it take
you
to fully recover?
That was in April. It was April a year ago. So it stopped production for several months. And then we finished up production late that summer. Yeah.
Okay, great.
And it worked for a while.
So we're seeing the season now. It's on Saturday nights, right? On TLC?
Mm-hmm. No, it's already aired, but you can watch it on TLC still.
Oh, okay. Okay. So we'll go online and watch it. Yeah. And I know that you are also a breast cancer survivor, as is my mom, as is 1 in 8 women who will get breast cancer. We hope that they survive. You know, what do you want to tell people about that? Again, just all the marches as far as charity organizations are going have been canceled and you know, fundraisers and things
like that. For me, because I really turned, when I discovered that I have breast cancer, we were in the throes of filming. I'm filming Say Yes to the Dress Atlanta and our bridesmaid show. So I've got 2 shows going, and I wasn't going to go in for my mammogram. And I threw that card over to the side. I remember doing it. It was a yellow card about this. I'm like, I'm not doing that this year.
Why did you? Did they discover it with a mammogram, or did you feel something and you thought?
No lung. Okay. Couldn't feel a thing. And so throw it over to the side, and they kept calling and calling. And I'm like, okay, you know, if you can squeeze me in, I'll go. So I go, and I have 2 types of breast cancer. After, you know, several mammograms, then a biopsy, then I have 2 types of breast cancer. I find that out, and my production, North South Production, I talk to them. My daughter's like, Mom, I really think you need to share this story. And I'm like, I don't want everybody knowing about my breast cancer. I mean, really? And she's like, yes, Mom, you've got a huge platform of women that could benefit from this story. So we started filming Say Yes to the Cure. I'll Say Yes to the Cure, Lori's Fight, about 2 weeks after I was diagnosed. And they went with me and filmed everything. You know, I had a lumpectomy. I still had a bunch of atypical cells. I ended up having to go back and have a double mastectomy. All of it was filmed. And, but I do think that we saved lives with that. Did I want to do it? No, I didn't want to film that. You know, that when many days I'm like, please get that camera out of my face, because I'm getting bad news, and you don't want this camera right in your face. But I found that to be my, that turned into my mission. And I have traveled all over the country and in Canada pretty much all of October. That's where I am. And right. I'm traveling and sharing my story, because otherwise I'm healthy as a horse, always have been. But this breast cancer, you couldn't feel it all the way back against my chest cavity. If I hadn't gotten that mammogram that year, I don't think I would be here still.
Yeah. Really, it's, I mean, my mom had, my dad had just retired. It was Christmas time. They were both about 75, I think.
Yeah.
And then she felt a little long, but she didn't say anything to anybody. My parents are very, you know, post-World War II generation, right. Stoic. She felt a lump and she called her doctor to say, hey, I felt this lump. And they said, well, it hasn't been a year since you've had your mammogram. So they kind of dismissed her.
Oh.
And my mom is, she's actually a trained nurse. She was a nurse when they first got together, my parents, but she, it was bothering her. She was listening to her body. Thank God.
Mm-hmm.
And so she called the doctor back and said, listen, I really need to get in there. I'm feeling a lump and I need to get in there. And so thank God she did. She had a lumpectomy, I think too. She didn't have to have a mastectomy. Thank God, because I've got the itty bitties from my mom, just like she has.
Yeah.
And you know, there's nothing left to take, but
I was in that same boat. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Chemotherapy, radiation, all the works, but thank God, you know, 6 years later, okay? she's great. But,
right.
But I think, I mean, a lot of, but she was embarrassed. I think I mentioned it one day on the radio too. And she was kind of embarrassed. I'm like, really? I mean, I don't know why there's shame associated with something like that. I mean, you might know, but I don't understand
that. I don't know that it's shame. I think it's fear. Yeah. I think we're afraid to show our vulnerability because women have to be so strong. You know, we have to be strong for our family and our children and at our job. And we have to be so tough. And I think it's fear. I think looking back at it now, why did I throw that card in the corner? I think I was afraid that maybe I wouldn't get a good mammogram. You know, I'm sure I was. So I'm going to throw that in the corner. I'm going to put that away and I'm not going to deal with that right now. But and I think as far as talking about it, it's very difficult to relive it over and over and over again. But I've found that the more you tell the story, it gets a little easier. And then as you hear people say, Lori, I got that mammogram because I came to the seminar where you spoke at or at the hospital or whatever, or I watched Say Yes to the Cure, and I got my mammogram as a result, and I had breast cancer. So, you know, you helped save a life there. And everybody needs to share that story. All women that have had breast cancer. There is a huge chapter in the book on breast cancer. And of course, the title of that chapter is One in Eight. Yeah. And One in Eight. And I don't like floss over it. Corey, I'm very honest about how difficult it was. Yeah. I went to Turning Point for therapy in Alpharetta.
Oh, really? Good.
We're so fortunate to have that. And it's for mastectomy patients. And, you know, I just about lived there while I was recuperating. And it really does take about a year out of your life. I mean, it just does. You're consumed with it. You got to get better. You got to start feeling better. And,
At least. I mean, you know, my mom lost her hair and she didn't even want my dad to see her, you know, without a hat on, you know.
Right.
But it's, you know, it came back like curly, so she didn't have to get a perm for a while. She loved that.
Right, right.
I
think to me, it showed me, you know, before then, I'd never, ever really been sick. The flu or something like that, never really been sick. I think it showed me just how strong and how much faith I have. And that combination is unstoppable. And that's why I wanted to spread that word, because I'm just a normal working mother, grandmother, all that. I'm just a normal lady that got breast cancer and I could deal with it. Am I proud of how I dealt with it? Yes. I did not let myself come unglued. And I talk about that a lot in my speeches too about breast cancer. You know, I think a really strong thing is to not read all that stuff and let yourself come unglued. I'm sure your mother didn't, because she's a nurse, right?
Yeah, she was, like, you know, 60 years ago.
Yeah, but I see people come unglued with the diagnosis, and that's not good.
I mean, she's I'm one of six kids, and she's got five grandkids, and so now she worries about her daughters and her granddaughters about, you know, getting it too. But, you know, I said, Mom, because she was kind of like, why? You know, because like you, she's had a very healthy life.
Right.
Unlike me, she's a teetotaler. you know, she's never really smoked, except in the 60s when they told you. Good for you, you know. I mean, she's really led a great, you know, life. She's got God in her life with Catholicism. She's right. the most devout Catholic I know. I just said, Mom, you know, sometimes, I mean, cancer's kind of coming for everyone, I think, unfortunately, or right. just something. We all kind of have to go through something in life, you know, and come out on the other side.
Yeah. I said, why me, many times. But then I thought about it and I'm like, well, why not you? You're not any different than anybody else, Laura. You know, you're not any better than anybody else. You're equal with everybody else. Why not you? You know, and maybe there's a reason you're the face of 1 in 8. And, you know, what do you do in these times of despair? You know, how do you push forward? And I think that resonates throughout the book. Not only is it, you know, how I handle and how I want people to handle times of despair, but I want them to have hope. And I want us to have hope now because I think people are so down in the dumps.
It's hard to tell because, again, I've been home alone for, I mean, I've lost count. I mean, I'm not counting because I actually think I'm probably going to be home till the end of the year at least.
Yeah.
But, you know, at least I'm happy and healthy and I got friends that'll come on a happy hour with me via uh-huh. video chat. I mean, I think if people use these tools, it would probably help them out a lot, you know, just be happier.
I think it would.
Just connect with people in any way possible.
Exactly. And make good use of this time we have now. You know, my husband and I don't go out to eat all the time now. We go pick it up, you know, but I do try to support local restaurants and, you know, we'll go have it delivered or whatever. But, you know, at this time, we're at home so much more now. So we can exercise more.
Yeah.
You know, we can read our devotionals more. We can just get out more outside. That's what we've been doing. A lot of walking.
Are you selling the book at the store?
Yes. Yes. I have some copies at the store. Absolutely. When I walked in, oh gosh, I had been on vacation. I have to tell you, I've always wanted to write this book. And it's really been a dream of mine to have it. And so when I walked in the store and saw those there, it literally took my breath away because they were all stacked on the desk. And I'm like, oh my God, I did it. You know, I did it. And it's not easy, honey, let me tell you. And I'll tell you what I think, Corey, was the hardest part of all of it was doing the Audible version because I read it myself.
Disney,
and I
would
get so choked up at some of the times and I'd have to stop and the nice man, I'm in a booth and it's dark and I'm starting to sweat because it's getting me upset. And the nice man would say, okay, just take a deep breath, Lori, and do that sentence again. And you can tell in my voice when I get choked up. But then I think that keeps it real.
Yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. You know, and again, a lot of people, I think, have a hard time starting. I mean, just even, you know, people out of college, they don't know what they want to do. And I think they feel lost. So, you know, and I don't know. I've heard it said that, you know, you kind of go back to when you were a kid. I mean, I used to entertain my family on road trips and make up commercials for stuff. Uh-huh. You know, I mean, I used to get in trouble all the time for talking and look at me now. Like, I can't stop talking.
My name is always on the board.
Oh, really? Me too. With check marks after it. I was that troublemaker. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Always.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I just, you know, it's just, if you don't know what you like to do, I guess you just have to encourage people to just try things.
You have to try different things. I'm not encouraging them to just quit their job tomorrow and go out and do something. Right. You know, I'm encouraging you to explore. You know, there's a big world out there to travel if you haven't, to, you know, to explore your passions. Maybe you've always wanted to take up art or you've wanted to work in the museum. You know, to explore it, to try it. Because I don't want to get to my last day and say, hey, you know, I left some crumbs of that cookie. I'm taking that thing all the way down, you know?
Yeah.
I think that's how we have to live our life.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm sure being 40 years in the bridal business, outfitting brides and bridesmaids and mothers of the bride. And I think you also do men's.
Yeah, we do tuxedo. Menswear, yes.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
So do you give advice? Do people ask you for advice, marital advice, things like that? Like my mom won't give it. She's like, oh, no, I don't give advice.
There's a huge chapter in the book called God's Grace and Elmer's Glue. Okay, that's how you get through marriage, with God's grace and Elmer's glue. Because there's going to be many days you want to half up kill them, you know?
Yeah.
It's not all roses. I tell people that all the time. I mean, it's Eddie and I have been married for 40 years, college sweethearts. And I say when we got married, we were young, dumb, and madly in love, okay? And we're still in love. But am I the same girl that he married, you know, at 21? No, I'm not. At 61, I'm not. And is he the same guy that I married? No, we've both given each other our space to grow, but knowing that we have made a commitment to each other. Now, I'm not saying in a stay together in an abusive relationship or anything like that.
Of course.
Yeah. I feel like now that people just give up too easy. Just that's not going to work. I'm out of here. You know, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So I like to see them, you know, try to work it out, give each other space to grow, but come together in the middle. You know,
yeah. That's, I mean,
God's grace, you know,
it's just, I mean, it's bizarre. I've never been married. And, you know, I'm not even anywhere close. And then you have the opposite of the spectrum. I have several friends that have been married twice, three times,
right,
and divorced three times.
Right.
You know, I mean, maybe marriage isn't for everybody.
Well, I see that. I think during, it's how you approach this. Yeah. The bride that is freaking out turns to bridezilla in alterations over like a bead loose on the top of her dress. That's really not what this is about. I feel like she's getting cold feet. There's way more to it than that. Way more. And you have to realize that. The bride that is just calm and happy all the way through, and, you know, and she's bringing, like, trying to merge the families together, like taking his grandmother's hanky or carrying it down the aisle, things like that.
Yeah.
Those are the ones that I feel like are going into this for a marriage and not three theatrics. Now, do I love a big wedding? Honey, I love a big wedding, but yeah.
Yeah.
But the bottom line is you're getting married. You know,
yeah.
That's what's important.
Well, and I know that I think your daughter is part of the business, as you kind of talked about. And I know that you probably outfitted her, and your son was also on the show when he got married, right?
And they had huge weddings.
Yeah. Really? Which was harder for you? Is it harder to see let go of your baby boy or your daughter?
Well, both of them are difficult. Now, my daughter doesn't work with me. She has her own advertising agency. But I think what's much more difficult than being mother of the bride is being mother of the groom. And I see it every day, and I talk a lot about it in the book. That chapter is entitled Wear Beige and Keep Your Mouth Shut. Okay? Because that's what the thing is for mothers of the groom to do. You're supposed to wear beige and you're supposed to keep your mouth shut. Okay. Well, beige matches my hair and I don't like beige. And I can't keep my mouth shut. So there's two things going in. I got two strikes already, as most women do. Now, I feel like the mothers of the groom can't win for losing. Now, I did not have that because Becca, thank God, knows I'm in this business, and her mother, and they're like, you're going to be all, and we were all up in it, and it was fine. Yeah. Great. But this cause what I do, but I see the bride all the time bring in this mother of the groom and act like she's done a really nice big thing because she let her come to the appointment. And I'm like, come on, you know, you're going to be spending how many Christmases with her? You know, you're not doing her a favor. You're marrying her son and you're merging these families together. So it's how you approach it. Yeah.
And I know you talk about, you know, how to avoid gray divorce, which is, I guess, divorce. What is that? Divorce after your first marriage or divorce after
getting married later? The children have gone. They're out of the house. And then you look at each other and you're like, who are you? You know, who is this person?
Right.
And you have to really rediscover your laughter and your fun again. And, you know, have a good time with each other again. And you have to respect each other. Eddie and I are a great team. Like, he's up here setting up the lights, getting my chair ready, you know, all that stuff for me.
Right.
As I would do the same for him, because we do this together as a team. And I think that is what's so important. I do.
Yeah, I do. I do think a lot of the best relationships, they look at each other or consider each other a team.
I should say.
But, you know, I mean, there is just so much divorce. And, you know, and once somebody has been divorced, their chances of being divorced again go up and then again, and they go up.
Right. And then the divorce rate's higher now because of the pandemic, they're saying.
Yeah.
So, because I guess everybody's getting on each other's nerves staying in the house all the time. So, you know, we have a lot to contend with right now. And I think that right now is the time to, you know, if you aren't getting along with your spouse and this is, you know, you maybe need to sit down and talk with him. It may be a great time to reevaluate your marriage and figure out how to work this out.
Yeah.
It's a great time.
Well, you know, and obviously you're a very, you have a lot of energy. You've done a lot of different things.
Yeah.
I love it. you have a lot of energy and you've done so many different things. How did the whole TLC Say Yes to the Dress thing even happen from the go?
Well, okay, the New York version started first, and they were on for a couple of years, and TLC actually called the store. And the reason they had heard about our store, you need a very large space in order to film. And my store is 25,000 square feet and it's three floors. Okay.
Yeah.
When we're filming, we're still open. Now we start really early in the morning. So usually you're not going to see customers all around, but later on into the film, you're going to start seeing customers wandering around and that, cause you got to stay open. You got a business to run. And, so they've got carts there and you know how it is, sound and the camera people, and then we're doing pickups in another room and all that sort of thing and interviews. So they contacted us and asked if they could shoot a pilot at the store. And I'm like, heck yes.
Good. You didn't have to.
I'd love to come down. So Monty wasn't working with me then. He worked for one of my designers and he and I were great friends. We've been like very best of friends for 20 years. Yeah. So I called him up and I said, Monty, TLC has called and wants us to shoot a pilot. Will you come down and shoot it with me? And of course, he was down on the next time. And we shot that pilot and it was greenlit in no time.
Oh, so that's fantastic.
Been a wonderful experience. It really has. And good. You know, me as a small business owner, I could never have this kind of advertising. So I'm thankful for it too. Even though it's a lot of work, I'm very thankful for it.
Right. I mean, I think it just helps generate business. The more you put your name out there, the book, I'm sure, will generate business too.
And, right. And you know what? The show is good for the city of Atlanta. We have so many people come in from everywhere because our show is shown in 120 countries.
Yeah.
So
wow, really?
Germany and Australia, all over Romania. And they're coming into the store and they're coming as a destination spot to browse in Bridals by Lori, look around, buy a t-shirt, you know, if I'm there, I need them. Yeah.
That's mm-hmm. that's amazing. And you know, I know you have brides on different budgets. Let's put it that way. And I think people tend to go just nuts when they can't afford to, you know. So how do you help them sort of decide? I mean, it's so tempting, you know.
Well, you know, I think some people think it's rude, but you have to, as the consultant first, and it's a very awkward situation because it makes me mad if they do not have this discussion with their family before they walk in the door. And you would be amazed at how many of them do not have that discussion, Corey. And so you'll look at them as they're looking through gowns and we're like, not to be rude, but we don't want you to try on an $8,000 gown if your budget is three. And you fall madly in love with it and then you're mad at us, you know, and you can't get it out of your head. So a lot of times, they'll look like a deer in a headlight and go, well, what's my budget? You know, to her parents or to the mom. It's an awkward conversation, but they need to have it before they walk into the door.
Yeah.
So that being said, a lot of times brides will try on gowns out of their budget. And we are very forthright with it. We'll say, now, just telling you, do you really want to try this on? Because this is a $7,000 gown. And your budget is $2,500. Now, do you want to try this on? Because, you know, what if you fall madly in love with it and you can't get it out of your head? You know, You know?
Well, and they say that, I mean, the reason why women like the textile part of shopping, we like to touch the fabrics and we like to see them on us. And then when they look fabulous on us, of course we want it, right?
Of course.
So,
and you know, online shopping for bridal gowns doesn't get it. This is an experience, and it should be. It's a touchy-feely experience. And even though the pandemic, we still have all kinds of customers coming in from everywhere because they want the experience of trying on gowns and connecting with a dress, because that's what it is. You connect with the dress. We can't make it happen, but we'll find, you know, we've got so many gowns up there, and we'll keep trying until we figure out what you want, and you connect with that dress, and then you say yes. I mean, that's a once in a lifetime thing. And this is the single most important garment you will ever wear. Yeah. It is.
So, well, maybe we'll see someday.
Yes, you're going to.
I know, and I'll be coming to you, I promise.
And you know, so it's important to women, you know, is that you feel wonderful on your wedding day. No matter if you've taken this wedding down that used to be 500 and there's only going to be 50 of you, you still need to feel fantastic. That part doesn't matter. You need to feel fantastic. You're getting married. You need a photographer. You need your flowers. Just scale it down.
Yeah, absolutely.
Later.
You don't even need shoes. I told my mom, it might be on the beach, mom. I may not be wearing shoes. And she's like, oh, Lord. Oh, Lord. Yeah. I need the dress.
Yeah.
I need the dress. So yeah. I know you have a couple of two or three celebrities on the season that just wrapped. But again, people can go on TLC.com. You can probably see it in reruns on TLC. And again, I think it's on Saturday nights, right?
Yes, for sure. On Saturday nights. New York has just started airing now.
Oh,
see, they filmed it before the pandemic, so they're just starting airing. Their season has started just airing now. But you can see the Atlanta version on TLC. Absolutely.
Okay, good. And who are the celebrities? I think one of the Duggars.
We had one of the Duggars on. I forgot about that. You know, it's been a while ago. But yeah, we did have the Duggar girl. Who else did we have on there?
I know. I mean, let me see if I can find it.
I can't remember. I found it in the info. Crazy time.
Yeah, I know. There was one gal that was a actual bride. And then I think the Duggar gal, I can't remember if somebody else in the family was getting married.
The bride was marrying the brother of the girl that's on the Duggar family. She was very nice. They were a very nice family.
Yeah.
Anyway, she was marrying her brother. That's how that season starts.
Wait. She wasn't marrying her brother, was she? I know they're Mormon.
No,
I thought you said. I'm like, oh, wow.
No. Her name's Jessa, and she's on the show, and she was marrying Jess's brother. Yeah.
I see. Okay.
You see what I'm saying? Yeah.
I see. Yeah. Well, and I've had a couple of radio sisters be on the show. I know Kristen Klingshern from 97 here in Atlanta.
Yeah.
She was on the show. Was she a bridesmaid or a friend of the bride?
She was a friend.
And okay,
she also got her dress at the shop, but we didn't film her when she got her dress. But yeah, beautiful. So yeah. We love her.
And then I think Angie Taylor from Kiss FM in Chicago, she may have been on the New York version. I'm not sure. Okay. Yeah, okay.
We found so many brides. We filmed for about 6 months for each season. And then, you know, from that 6 months of filming, then they narrow it way down. So, you know, it's a lot of brides, and then they narrow it down to who they're going to take.
I see. I mean, so they shoot a lot of video footage and then they decide who they're going to take.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I was like, how does somebody get on the show?
They apply online. When we're filming, it pops back up and you can apply online or you can apply at TLC. And then they'll Skype with you. Now, right now there's no filming going on, but they'll Skype with you and then they'll call you in. And it really has to actually be a shopping experience for you.
Right.
You can't have your dress already. You know, we are actually doing our job and trying to find you the gown of your dreams. So,
what is the range of prices and gowns that you have? I mean, how many do you have? You said 25,000 square feet is the
store. 25,000 square feet. So on the bridal floor for couture gowns, we usually have around 1,000, maybe more upstairs. And then I have an outlet department, which is the discontinued gowns from upstairs, and you can get great savings down there. That's our little hidden secret. So we have the outlet department here, which those are off the rack, and those gowns range in price from like $1,500 to say $3,000. And then upstairs, they start at $2,500 and go up, and they can go way up. Depends on it depends on what we're doing. If we're doing like you a custom dress or making a train that's 18 feet long, we can do all that.
Well, and it's funny because not funny, but it's only funny because you're fine and you're healing and all that stuff. But when I was reading the description of your accident, it says you tripped on a train. I was like, was she down at MARTA? Like what train was she trying to get on?
That kind of train. Yeah.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. I was like,
I would have been down at MARTA. I wouldn't have fallen on my face. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Well, that's exciting. So what is happening with you right now? I mean, are you going to do a book tour? I mean, what happens during a pandemic?
See, all this, it's just been crazy.
Yeah.
All this, we have planned on being up in New York for 2 weeks in July and doing all the shows and the media and all that sort of thing. So now I'm Skyping like crazy. And, you know, and then we have the pandemic. So we're trying to get some good news in there with all the pandemic stuff going around. You know, there's a lot of noise out right now. And it's difficult to get the message across of the book, but I'm trying my best, you know, because I am not giving up. I just feel so strongly about it. I don't benefit from it. I feel strongly about it. And I want to motivate women. That's what I want to do.
Yeah.
So I'm going to keep talking.
Yeah, I know. And I don't blame you. I mean, that's a smart thing to do. When I had Chef Irvine from the Food Network, he goes, this is the way that business is being done now. It's like everything is video, everything is Skyping, Zoom.
Right.
And, you know,
Skype and Zoom.
just to your point, to the book, to the show, just say yes. And mm-hmm. and it's interesting to me, the people that don't, but they are successful. I'm like, all right, okay. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't get it. I would say yes to a lot of things. I mean, I'll say yes to helping anybody. If anybody needs help with audio or video or just their resume, I mean, there is nothing to lose by helping somebody else. There really isn't.
And actually say yes to your future. You know, don't get in your house now and go, oh my God, the world's falling in. What are we going to do? We're going to get through this, y'all. I mean, we're going to get past this. The world's not falling in, and we're going to get through it, and we have to have faith and hope, and that's going to get us through this. We will get past this, and we're going to look back at this time and think at all these people. We're going to say, we had a lot of resolve. We were tough, just like I did with breast cancer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, you have to be resilient. You just have to be, and know that a better day is coming. I mean,
that's right.
There's time to come, and there's a light at the end of the tunnel, another cliche, but it's true.
That's true. Yeah,
I mean, just take care of your health.
I mean, otherwise, what are we going to do? Hide under a blanket?
No. Mm-hmm. I mean, unless it's pouring rain out, but it's been hotter than Hades all over America.
Miserable. Can't even stand it.
I know. I love it. I love your accent. I love the Southern girl in you. And I guess I want to leave this with, you know, what is next for you? You're pushing the book or getting out there and telling people about the book and telling them, you know, giving them a bright light and something to be motivated about.
Well, I have no intention of retiring. So Bridals by Lori here forever. We're safe.
Right.
So that's number one. Number two, I will continue breast cancer speeches. There's none for October, but I'm sure by next October, I'll be back on the circuit again. I will continue to spread the message of mammograms and how important that is. And the third thing I want to do, you know, in my resume here is I really want to do motivational seminars for women to inspire women to live their best life after 50. I mean, we are the largest demographic of people with the most money, and yet depends and walkers. That's what
I know. I mean, with any financial decision, especially if it's in a couple, I think it's women that are sort of the decision makers when it comes to cars and homes. Mm-hmm. Yet I was telling my brother-in-law, he was visiting for a couple of days. He's a physician in San Diego.
Yeah.
And he has a daughter, my niece, who is, I think she's 23. And I told him, I said, do you realize that in my lifetime, women could not get a credit card in their name until the 70s. They had to have like permission from their husband.
Didn't that make you mad?
You would like to think that we've come a long way with so many different issues, but here we are in 2020 and we're
in some respects we have, but not totally.
Mm-mm. Yeah, mm-mm. I know.
And especially as a woman starts to age,
yeah,
you know, that's when you really start hearing it.
Well, that's when you need to get feistier than ever, in my
opinion. I agree. We need to have our ducks in a row.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so where's the best place to go to find out all the information about you and what you got going on this summer and beyond?
Yeah, just go to loriallen.com, LoriAllen.com, and you'll find out all kinds of info. And my book's for sale on there, and it'll take you to the places it's for sale. Yeah.
Okay, good. Well, Lori, thank you for joining us tonight. Happy hour. I wish I could share one of these with you in person. Maybe someday.
We'll get together once this is over and have one.
Okay.
A mojito. I love a mojito, girl.
Oh, I can make, and I have a mint plant outside. Okay. I mean, you can come over here or I'll bring them to you.
I'll do it. And you can try on a bridal gown. Let's do it.
I've only, to be honest, I went to a bridal fair once. I was doing a remote for the radio station back in Seattle, and I did try one on, but that is the only, maybe I'll manifest that for 2021. Uh-huh. I will try on a gown that I really like, and I'll manifest Mr. Wright walking in the door.
Yep. And walk in the runway at Bridals by Lori. That's what you're going to do for
2020. Oh, I would love that.
Then we're going to celebrate with a mojito.
Okay, yes. Absolutely. Maybe a few.
Thank you. Right.
Thank you, Lori. Have a wonderful, wonderful weekend. And thank you so much again for joining us. We'll get the book.
Thanks for having me.
Say yes to what's next. That's the book by Lori Allen. Mm-hmm. All right. Thanks, Lori. Have a wonderful day.
Bye, hon. Bye-bye.